Oh, hey, welcome back. Before we get started with this chapter, just wanted to say that, you know, being at home, not being able to go to school, see friends, see family that lives outside of my house, you know, sometimes it can take a toll on a person. And today, earlier, I was feeling pretty down. So one thing that I like to do when I'm feeling down is think back to the times when I was happy. So one thing that I did was I went through my phone and looked at some pictures and videos that I've had on there for almost a year. So I thought I would share some of those with you. Check these out.
You got a friend in me. When the road looks rough ahead and you're miles and miles from your nice warm bed, you just remember what your old past said. Boy, you got a friend in me.
Yeah, you got a friend. Better put her down.
You got a friend in me. You got a friend in me. You got trouble, and I got them too. There isn't anything I wouldn't do for you. We stick together, see it through, 'cause you've got a friend in me. You got a friend in me. Some other folks might be a little bit smarter than I am, big and stronger too, maybe, but none of them will ever love you the way I do. It's me and you, boy, and as the years go by, our friendship will never die. You're gonna see it's our destiny. You got a friend in me. You got a friend in me. You got a friend in me.
All right. Welcome back. What did you think? Pretty good, right? Some funny ones in there. Okay. We're going to start reading chapter 8. Subtitle is Southview Avenue, Ukabuka Land. Gather, gather, gather round, ladies and gentlemen, leopards and giraffes, lollipops and gummy bears, lizard lips and googly eyes, and yes, even you, Miss Stevens. I am the super, super say-so, and I've come to make you laugh until you pass. Pass what, you ask? Pass gas, pass out, pass away. Pass anything other than class. Careful. Miss Stevens warned her from behind the desk in the corner of the room. She sat with her arms folded, watching Cynthia say so sour, put on the show in front of the class. This was the only way to keep Cynthia from disturbing and derailing the entire lesson. If Miss Stevens didn't give her those 5 minutes at the end, Cynthia would burst into some kind of sideways monologue about whatever Miss Stevens had been teaching that day, like how negative numbers deserve empathy because no one should ever feel lower than zero. I mean, wouldn't you feel a little negative too if people kept saying you less than nothing? You basically don't even really exist. You're under. Your mama done probably kicked you out. Your girlfriend or boyfriend done broke up with you, and when you ask why, they just said something like, you ain't enough for me. So tell me, who is crying for the negative number? Who, Miss Stevens? Who? Cynthia would wail and flail overdramatic fists in the air, all leading up to the big finish. Cynthia planting her face flat on the desk, cheek to wound. And all right. And right when Miss Stevens would think it was over, Cynthia would lift up and ask, You know what I would do if I was a negative number? There was only one answer. Cynthia, don't you dare, Miss Stevens warned, knowing what was coming. There was always only one answer. I would. One answer and the whole class knew it. Cynthia, seriously? Miss Stevens shook her head. And because the whole class knew it, they joined in and said it with her. Run! Cynthia would jump up from her desk and charge out of the classroom, but only for a second. Then she'd come back as if it never happened, have a seat at her desk, straighten her posture, pick up her pencil with one hand, and play with the two plaits sprouting from either side of her head, a hairstyle she loved for its comedic effect with the other. Miss Stevens used to call out for her, used to stutter step toward the door, used to threaten to write her up. Don't divide me from class, Miss Stevens. Please, don't divide us, Cynthia would fake beg, doubling down on the math joke. Oh, I'm not planning on doing any division, Cynthia. I'm thinking more along the lines of subtraction. But Miss Stevens never did. Truth is, she liked Cynthia's jokes. It reminded her of old comedians on the black and white TV shows her grandmother used to watch when she was a child. So, she cut the goofball a deal. If Cynthia could be attentive and serious all class, she would get the last 5 minutes to do her thing. So, L's and G's, let's start with the news. This just in. Shirt. It's a strange word, right? I mean, seriously, there had to be better options when it came to naming this. Cynthia tugged at the collar of her t-shirt. I heard, and this is just what I heard, a long, long, long time ago. There was this dude who was a clothes maker, and he invented this thing to cover your chest and arms and stuff. Now, when he first made it, he called it an arm-belly chest cloth. But that name was too long, so then he shortened it to an ABC. But then, the ABCs came out. And, you know, that became a whole thing with the song and the cool LMNOP part. And the next thing he knew, everybody was doing it. And the clothes maker realized maybe ABC wasn't the best name to call his arm belly chest cloth. But he ain't have another name for it. One night, he was sitting with a friend. No, not one friend. A bunch of his friends at a dinner. Everybody trying on his arm belly chest cloth thing, right? And the clothes maker is nervous because people love it and they keep asking him what it's called. And when he tells them, their faces drop like they can't believe it. That's too long of a name. We call shoes shoes, not toe cover-uppers, they said. Now, see, the clothes maker was a nervous eater. I forgot to tell y'all that part. Every time he got stressed out or, like, anxious, he would eat. And now he was nervous because everyone was saying his garment wouldn't work unless he changed the name. So, what are you going to change it to? They asked. And instead of responding, he just started stuffing bread in his mouth. Bread, bread, bread. Just pushing it in there. What are you going to name it? They repeated. And do you know what the clothes maker said with the mouth full of rolls? Pause for effect. I'll tell you what he said. Cynthia wound up. The clothes maker shrugged and said, all muffled, sure, I don't know. And before the ruckus could even come, Miss Stevens shut it all down. Okay, okay, that's enough for today, she said, trying not to laugh herself. There was no need to cut Cynthia off because the punchline landed at the exact moment the bell rang. Perfect timing. Cynthia's mother worked all day and went to school all evening. And when Cynthia was a baby, her mother would rock her to sleep with bedtime stories read out of night school textbooks. She was Cynthia's hero, a hero too busy to save her, a hero too hardworking to even find time to laugh, but a hero nonetheless. But Cynthia's grandfather was her superhero. Not in the superhuman sense, but in the way that there was something incredible about him, at least to Cynthia. To almost everyone else, He was just a wild ex-soldier who owned a liquor store right in front of her apartment building. The kind of man who would take a wooden crate, flip it upside down, then step up on it and put on a show. Hold court right there in the middle of the store. Jokes were his superpower. The dirtier, the better. Cynthia was even named after him. His name was Cinder, and whenever he'd introduce himself to people, they'd always ask, "Cinder, like Cinderella?" And he'd say, "Nah, Cinder, like Cinderblock." But really, he was a bit of both, had a toughness to him, a hard-headed, hard-handed, hard-talking man. But he was also soft enough to hold baby Cynthia and stare at her and laugh like she was the greatest joke ever told. Soft enough to know a good sidekick when he saw one. Soft enough to give her a nickname. Sweetie Say So. Named her that because of all the goo-goos and ga-gas and grunts Cynthia would make whenever Cinder would pick her up. A noisemaker. Always a noisemaker. And Cinder would just salute her and say, "Sweetie, if you say so. If you say so, sweetie." Cinder's girlfriend, a gray-haired, lipstick, cigarette-smoking male woman named Miss Fran, would always come by his store to deliver letters and bills, always catching him in the middle of his jokester routines. She'd laugh in this way that made all the bottles in the store rattle, made all the men jealous of all the love thing she and Cinder had. And when she came on Saturdays, she'd always catch Cynthia marching around the outside of the front of the store, prompted by her grandfather and Miss Fran. And Miss Fran would stick stamps on Cynthia's chubby cheeks and forehead. "I'm going to put you in the mailbox. Ship you off to Ooka Booka Land," she'd tease. And Cynthia would laugh and scream, "No!" as if Ooka Booka Land were a real place. Miss Fran died when Cynthia was 7. Hurt Cynthia to lose the only grandmother she'd ever known. But her sadness was nothing compared to Cinder's. Seemed like Cinder's mind floated away with Miss Fran's spirit and voice. Or maybe it went underground with her body, buried in the cemetery across the street from the liquor store. Cinder could see her gravestone from the window of his fourth floor unit he and Miss Fran had lived in together, 5 doors down from where Cynthia lived with her mom. It wasn't long after Miss Fran's death that Cinder closed the liquor store. It wasn't long after the store closed that it was knocked down. It wasn't long after it was knocked down that the apartment complex built a playground where it used to be. A sliding board, a set of swings, a seesaw, a stage. Not a big, elaborate stage, just a concrete platform about the size of all the wooden crates Cinder used to stand on in the store. A bronze plaque bolted to it that read, "Cinder's Block." Cynthia hoped that maybe he'd step up on it someday, crack a joke or two. But he never would, because it wasn't long after the store was turned into a playground that Cinder started to forget things. How to turn on the radio, how to work the microwave. And every time something simple would slip his mind, Cynthia would have to come over to help. "Remind me how to turn on the TV, say so. Don't seem to want to work for me," Cinder would say, pointing the case he kept his eyeglasses in at the television screen. Wasn't long after Cinder started to forget things that Cynthia and her mother moved down the hall into her grandfather's 2-bedroom apartment. Cinder had his room, Cynthia and her mother had the other, which meant most nights, because her always exhausted mother slept like a woman fighting a bear, Cynthia slept on the couch dreaming of the day she could make her mother laugh. Dreaming of the day she could be funnier. Dreaming of the day she could funny her mother free of all the work, of all the stress she seemed to wear on her face like thick makeup the wrong color for her skin. Dreaming of her mother telling her a joke. Knock, knock. And Cynthia replying, "Who's there?" And her mother saying, "Me." And Cynthia not having to say, "Me who?" That's all Say So ever wanted. A love thing with her mother, the way her grandfather had with Miss Fran, through laughter, And since her mother was too busy to break, well, then anyone would have to do. A smile is a smile. A ha is a ha. So every day she'd rattle off her jokes at the end of class, bathing in her classmates' crack-ups, including today. As everyone rushed out of Miss Stevens' class, Cynthia stood at the door handing out flyers. Not the kind that are professionally printed with graphics and lasers and cool shadow effects. Those were just pieces of lined notebook paper. These were just pieces of lined notebook paper, ripped into squares, with soggy edges because she believed in the lick and rip method. That said, written in red, "Say so, live on cinder block at the Southview Apartments. Show starts at 3:33. Be there or be Mr. Fontana's forever wedgie," Cynthia teased. She didn't know where that one came from, but she let it loose and let it live. Down the hall she went, stopping at her locker, grabbing her things, and headed for the door, pausing only to tell her friend Gregory Pitts that he smelled like his last name. She told him this every day just because. Just because. And Greg, knowing it was a joke, flapped his arms like a bird, wafting the pit funk toward her. 3:33, she called out to him. Be there. When she got outside, instead of taking the long way she usually took and walking the way most of the walkers went, which was up to the corner where Miss Post was, orange-vested, waving cars by, and blowing her whistle until the face looked like it would pop, Cynthia instead walked through the grass and headed toward the back of the school to take the shortcut. She could have gone through the back door, which would have been an even shorter cut, but then she would have missed snapping on Greg. And who could avoid the opportunity to roast? Plus, she'd learned from her grandfather a long time ago how important tradition was. She walked along the side of the school, dragging her fingers on the red brick of the building until she reached the trees, the line of trees at the back. Not exactly a forest, just a single line of maples that created a barrier between the school and the road. When Cynthia reached the tree line, the trees thick with limbs that looked less like arms and more like outstretched legs, thick-rooted yoga trees, she hiked her jeans up above her ankles and tiptoed, because the land always seemed to be muddy there. On the other side of the trees was Kerrigan Street, known for nothing besides the entrance to Southview Cemetery. The cemetery had a regal iron gate wrapped around it and took up the entire block. Cynthia, after looking both ways, ran across the street and into the cemetery because through the graveyard was the shortest way home. No point in going around when she could go through. Plus, she had to get giggles for her grandfather. Giggles were cigarette butts. Cinder collected them, and Cynthia always tried to make sure to find some if she could. People were always walking through the cemetery, smoking and leaving their leftover cigs on the ground. And sometimes, even leaving them on the gravestones along with flowers, pictures, notes, bottles, and candles. But the giggles were what she was looking for, what Cinder always wanted. But she hadn't named them that. Cynthia had. Shortly after Miss Fran died, Cynthia was helping her grandfather clean the apartment, helping him organize his papers and clothes, helping him straighten up. "You want this?" she asked, holding up an old Vietnam veteran's hat. "Uh-huh." "These?" Cynthia asked, holding up a stack of stamps and envelopes. "I ain't mailing nothing, so nah," Cinder said. Cynthia peeled one of the stamps from the book, stuck it on her forehead, then made a funny face at her grandfather. He smiled, and she put the rest of the stamps in her back pocket. "What about all this?" she then said, holding up an ashtray full of cigarette butts, red lipstick smudged on the tips. He looked, leaned into the ashtray. Kind of looked like he was leaning over the ledge of a pool, threatening to fall in. He picked one up, looking at it like it was a single bullet, one that could explode his heart, but didn't. At least not in the way Cynthia thought. Cinder's eyes watered, but he didn't cry. He giggled. Cynthia traipsed around the cemetery, looking for giggles and finding none. There were people walking their dogs through the graveyard, others visiting their family members, sweeping their areas, picking up trash, replacing dead flowers with live ones. Cynthia saw two girls sitting on a skateboard in front of a tombstone. She thought she recognized them, but didn't want to stare because it would have been weird. She kept walking, kept looking, eyes running across the tops of the stones that had names engraved in them. But she was running out of time. It was 3:26 p.m., 7 minutes until the say-so show. So she figured she may have struck out this time. She may not have any new giggles to give her grandfather. But then she came to Miss Friend's grave. And sitting on top of it was a cigarette butt. Lipstick kissed the end of it. Cynthia took it as a sign, slid it into her pocket, and headed on. After she came out on the other end of the cemetery, the Southview Avenue side, she crossed the street over to where the playground was. There was a little girl sitting on a swing, kicking her legs, flying back and forth, static electricity for hair, happiness for her face. But she was the only person there, and it was 3:31 p.m. Cynthia sat on Cinder's block, stretched to crack her back. The couch seemed to be making her body old, and when she thought about that, it made her laugh. I bet the reason a couch is called a couch is because of the ouch part, she said to herself, or maybe to the swinging girl. But the swinging girl was swinging and not listening. Yeah, that's not a good one. 3:32 p.m. A bird landed next to her, a pigeon, a dingy gray that was somehow still beautiful, like clouds before rain. Yeah, I always wing it anyway, she said to the bird. I wonder what it must be like to be you. It's like you get wings so you can fly anywhere you want to go, which is pretty much the most amazing thing ever. You can fly to the things you want, but the letdown is when you get to wherever the things you want are, you ain't got the hands to grab it. And that one made her laugh a little. 3:33 p.m. No one came. But no one ever came. Well, that's not true. Sometimes Gregory Pitts, Remy Vaughn, Joey Santiago, and Candace Green would come. But that's just because they lived in Southview, too. Cynthia figured her low attendance was because people had to go home after school. You know, parents, practice, homework, stuff like that. Either that, or they never thought she was being serious about her shows. That whole 3:33 thing, which is part of her act. Part of the joke. Part of the say-so thing. And so they were all thinking, yeah, okay, if you say so, right. Of course. Truth was, 3:30 p.m. was for Cynthia's mother. She got off work as a barista at 3, and she had school, now graduate school, at 4:15. She always went straight to class, but if for some reason she decided to skip, to take a day off, to give herself a break, Cynthia would be right there, standing on Cinder's block, ready to joke a smile onto her hero's face. Just the way her superhero had taught her. But there are no days off for a hero. So Cynthia opened her backpack, pulled her notebook out, and snatched a page loose. She dug out a pen and started scribbling the joke about the bird and it not having hands and how awesome it would be to have wings if you also had hands. But then that would make birds angels. And how it would be way too scary to see angels with beaks. And that made her laugh too. Cynthia then pulled out an envelope and a stamp. She kept them in the small pocket of the front of her bag. She folded the paper, slid it into an envelope, sealed it, then wrote her own address on it. After that, she slapped the stamp on it. She peeled another stamp from the book and walked over to the little girl on the swing. Want a sticker? Cynthia asked. The little girl stopped swinging, held her hand out, and Cynthia stuck the sticky square to the back of it. Charlie Chaplin. When she got upstairs to her apartment, Cynthia dropped her bag on the couch and beelined to her grandfather's room. Knocked. Grandpa, Grandpa, I got mail. No answer. Knocked again. Grandpa, it say so. Mail. Nothing. Concerned, Cynthia turned the knob. Opened the door slowly. Grandpa? He was there, sitting on the side of his bed, scribbling in his notepad. Paper balls littered the floor. So many that the door swept a bunch of them to the side of the room. That wasn't unusual. There were always paper balls. Most with random sentences on them. Starts and stops, his hand holding a pen, spitting whatever was coming from his sputtering mind. But a few were not in his handwriting. A few had been snatched from envelopes written in loopy cursive of the coolest granddaughter in the world. Grandpa, you hear me knocking? Cynthia asked. Cinder looked up at her, and for a moment it seemed like he didn't recognize her. Finally. Oh, say so. I didn't hear you. In here trying to get my jokes together. Trying to write a zinger for you to take to school tomorrow, you know? Cynthia came to his side. Kissed his cheek, looked down at the paper. All he had written down was the word eardrums. Eardrums, huh? Yeah, it's not working. He ripped it out, balled it up, and tossed it on the floor. I got something else I think is better, but I don't know. Anyway, how was school? I killed. You did the shirt joke? Yeah, and it crushed him. Your mother used to love that joke. His voice sweetened for a moment. Then he continued, your teacher ain't get mad, did she? No, she was cool about it, Cynthia reassured him, remembering the cigarette butt in her pocket. Oh, I almost forgot. I found a giggle. She pulled the red-stained tip from her pocket, dropped it in his palm. Cinder let it roll around, staring down at it for a second before smiling. He got up from the bed and dropped it in a bottle on the small table a few feet away. Adding it to what looked like 100, maybe more. And some mail came for you. Cynthia held the envelope out. The one that she'd stuffed with the paper she'd written her bird joke on. The one that she'd simply written her own address, which was his address on. Nothing else. Grandpa took the envelope and set it on the table. Cynthia knew that later he would open it, read it, and forget he'd read it. And believe he wrote it. And the next day, he'd tell her to write a new joke in Miss Stevens' class. And she'd tell him she would, and come home and tell him his jokes were working. His jokes were still cracking people up. And he'd say things like, we a good team, ain't we? Or, like father, like daughter. And Cynthia would kiss his cheek and nod. Cynthia headed back toward his bedroom door. Before leaving, she turned and asked, what was the other thing? Cinder looked confused, so Cynthia continued. The joke. You said you were thinking about something else. Oh, just this thing I was kicking around, but I don't think it'll work. What was it? Tell me. Okay. Cinder steadied himself, looked his granddaughter in the eye. What would happen if a school bus fell from the sky? Cynthia thought for a second, a smile creeping onto her lips. I mean, is it coming from Ukabuka land? Silence. Just that thought between them. Cynthia looking at her grandfather, her Cinderella, her cinder block, the man who taught her to perform, taught her that life is funny most of the time, and the times it ain't funny are even funnier. There ain't no forgetting that. He looked back at her, and in a way that only grandfather and granddaughter could do, together, Cynthia and Cinder split open and laughter poured out of them, a laughter free enough to make the bottle of giggles on the table rattle. All right, so that's it for chapter 8. Great story about a girl and her granddad and the relationship they have with one another. All right, there's some questions on Schoology. Please make sure you answer those. If you have any questions, don't hesitate to send me a message. All right.